So just before I start, I just want to position the work first. I borrowed my title from Paul Hegarty, Noise is Phenomenology of Noise. And of course, in borrowing that, I adapted what he's now moved beyond insofar as I now have. I'm still working in a kind of a quasi-aporic crossroads. So yeah, there's that. And this is just kind of a set of work that's slightly moved beyond a larger work, so it's still rather open and also bases on a set of artistic practice that I won't talk about today. So if anyone's interested in that sort of thing and how this theory would ground or speak to a parallel practice, you can chat. So I want to get towards a failing phenomenology that reminds us of what sound is, the matter of sound, while remembering the limits of matter and experience. Today I'm going to do this through a parasitic approach, attaching to selections of moments from Jacques Derrida to force my figure of noise latently out from in between in order to think how sound is written between experience and the matter in the world without positing a false sense of presence, like full presence, or offer a way to it, and while offering a way to attune to the noise of the absent matter. Two quick qualifications of the noise as it will be latently found here. First, I want to think of noise as divorced from judgment in the sense that it gains in cybernetics of being an interruption or excess leading to disorder, an unexpected information occurring in a relation which opens to the possibility of noise being read positively. Second, noise in this sense found here cannot be thought as a phenomenon, but instead must be thought as an effect of a mediated relationship between two points. The biggest implication of this second point has been thought extensively by Michel Serres, is that noise cannot be thought under the figure of phenomenology because it belongs to the domain of being or ontology. So what I'm arguing here for is that noise forces an opening to think phenomenology in a phenomenal sense, phenomenology in an inverted relation to ontology, where it is a means to think not experience, but the absent world, to parody Heidegger's parody of Husserl in Being of Time, which is to let that which shows itself be seen from itself in the very way in which it shows itself. Rather, I'm going to attune to what's given in experience. I'd rather offer a way of attuning to that which is unheard, to let that which does not show itself be unheard in the very way in which it grounds experience itself in the matter of its absence. Phenomenology in this failed sense, then, becomes a means to think the effect of the relation of relation as it unveils noise, not so much contingent on experience or consciousness in the classical phenomenology sense, but as the object of as non-present, only appearing in the traces written over by or into experience. I do not intend to inscribe, again, a sense of presence in the world in experience, but rather to put forward something that forces the background into the foreground, if only to remember what is excluded from what is included in experience. So before moving into Derrida's later writings, I want to set forward some groundwork from Of Grammatology, which writes an expansion of writing into not only, to quote, not only the physical gestures of literal pictographic or ideographic inscription, but also the totality of what makes it possible. With writing expanded in such a way as to encompass sound and beyond, we can start to think the traces of sound in this writing. Sound in the world, then, is left under Erasure and Derrida's system of écriture. It is there, but neither can be addressed directly nor ignored completely because it's matter traced into the larger motions of writing. Experience in general, or sound in this purview, is the palimpsest on which the trace is written, though of course the same could be said of a visual sight or otherwise. As an example, we can look to Différence, which plays a central role in Derrida's system in Of Grammatology. The erasure of matter is written into the very word Différence. Much like noise, Différence performs its meaning not only as a concept, but as a process, with the written addition of the A instead of the E, which is unheard in French. Derrida collects to differ and to defer, performing the erasure that insists that one, to quote, one can always act as if it makes no difference. But Différence does make a difference. It tracks the break between matter and the world through the process of writing of the trace. Moreover, the silent A can escape not only hearing but vision as well, which suggests the Différence in erasure, to quote, must be permitted to refer to an order which no longer belongs to sensibility, but neither can it belong to intelligibility. Instead, Différence is located between speech and writing, beyond the tranquil familiarity which links us to one and the other, occasionally reassuring us in our illusion that they are two. With the differing and deferring within écriture comes the blurring of what is given in experience and the ground of experience. The limits inscribed by différence make way for noise, as everything is mediated by writing and therefore generates noise in relation. Sound, in grammatology, plays a central role, first in his critique of presence, created the difference without delay between that which denotes difference and the differences as denoted, or in the terminology of grammatology, that which is effaced in the domain of the signifier in order for the signified meaning to come forward, a process that is enmeshed in time and without the ability to reach for meaning in the world outside of the logic of the sign. So meaning, in the sense here, or the communication of it, only communicates with itself. The second key role of sound and of grammatology comes out with sound unheard, a stand-in that appears for matter, sonic or otherwise, through which experience and all else is written. To quote, the unheard difference between the appearing and the appearance, between the world and lived experience, is the condition of all other differences, of all other traces, and is already a trace. Here Derrida is using la personne and la partie, which literally translates to appearing or to appear, to draw the difference between the present participle and its infinitive, to mark matter in the world and matter heard through the temporal split of the trace. Matter in the world, for Derrida, is always already written. It's always already a trace, whether or not it's experienced. The expansion from narrow writing to écriture encompasses world and experience, and is one absently a part of the other. So here again, this is the same movement that has been made with noise, where it doesn't rely on a set of judgment, it doesn't rely on experience, but rather is written into the world and able to come forward through an interruption or exceeding. So just that it's kind of put aside in terms of judgment or experience. The trace that opens Derrida's project in of grammatology develops through the later writings in the figure of the cinder. Il y a la cendre, there are cinders there, cinders there are. Cinders in the text are written as a polylogue, a conversation staged between the left and right sides of the page, with the left side focusing on the cinders in previous writings, or previous texts, where the right side writes in and out of those remains. Furthermore, in the French edition, the text becomes a polyphony in the recording featuring the text read by Derrida and Caroline Bouquet, with Stockhausen's Stingham in the background. With the different mediums come different strands of noise, remainders reminding the matter of materiality. Derrida clarifies his image of matter in that which remains from what is not, in order to recall its delicate charred bottom of itself, only non-being or non-presence. Being without presence has not been and will no longer be there, where there is cinder and where this other memory would speak. There, cinder's other means the difference between what remains and what is. Cinders there are, cinders there are. La, written with an accent grave, there, cinders there, and this is to quote, there is, there, cinders, but the accent, although readable to the eye, is not heard, cinder there is. To the ear, the definitive article la risks effacing the place and any mention of memory of the place. The adverb la effaces la, that's the split between the one with the accent and one without. La faces herself, himself, twice rather than once. So in this way, cinders establishes a sense of place that will never be able to be translatable as it moves towards the prescribed limits. And this sense of place is marked by noise in the sense of absent matter. Another way of thinking this would be via terroir, the sense of place that's referred to in the wine world as the composite sets of quality reflected in the taste of a wine. So there's no experienceable difference between the world and lived experience of the world, yet the two domains remain always already written into one another through the movement of écriture. Derrida's refrain of cinders, that which has marked a number of his works, turns back on itself and moves its sense of place while shifting its sense of time. Its presence is inscribed while deferring into the futurity of the past. In cinders, as well as with différence and elsewhere, Derrida's used the split matter of the mediums of writing and vision and writing sound to amplify the matter of cinders, tracing through them the matter of difference in their specific volume in such a way that each medium is affected or reinvented by the other. The cinders arrive for relation and do not form a subject and are thus adjacent to noise, in my sense, left on the limits of phenomenology and ontology because it's not accessible by the tools of traditional phenomenology in the study of consciousness, experience of experience. The cinder is not merely the substance or matter of form, but rather, as Derrida notes, in the relation to the trace, the formation of form. Examples like difference and cinders, thence, are what I want to take as amplifiers of noise, devices to amplify the absent matter and its noise burnt into written experience. So the noise is taken as a mechanism, not for understanding, but for practice of altering attunement towards what is already absent, shifting towards rhythmics of slowness to remember what is not. So not stopping, as Derrida warns against in Ephemerographies of Television. And there's a section here that I kind of reduced down that would have talked more about slower durations and effects of process and failure. So not stopping, but finding ways in which to slow the progressions of experience, if only momentarily or in effect. Slowing time to experience the noise of the relation of relation. So phenomenology here, as I'm suggesting, and kind of leaving open, is something to gain traction rather than a rigorously thought inversion with ontology. Breaking phenomenology through the noise of noise, the relations of the world, were not contingent on our experience of them, but happens to enter with the relation with our experience. After this failed phenomenology, what's left is the cinders of sound, sounding matter whose resonance marks the absence of its matter. Noise in the selected moments before forces into motion the hinge between matter and experience, the limits between classical phenomenology and ontology. So although attuning to the noise of this hinge, and through attuning to the noise of this hinge, we are reminded of the fragments of the world that are burnt into experience. Speculative work can be done and is being done to amplify the effects of this hinge, not to establish a presence of something that cannot be anything other than what it is, absent, but to foreground this absence as a reminder of the there, but to foreground this absence as a reminder of the there of what is not there. Thanks.